Welcome to the session on Aesthetics and Cultural Studies. Over the past 30 or so years, cultural studies has grown to become a major academic institution. According to many of its 1990s textbooks, this advance has entailed a radical departure from the sociology of culture. In art, history and aesthetics, the shift towards visual culture is occurring for many reasons. Theoreticians associated with the study of visual culture argue that its usage is increasing in response to the proliferation of images challenging the hegemony of text and spoken word. The area of study defined under the term visual culture is very vast, as it assumes that the processes and products of culture are studied in relation to multiple contexts such as politics, economics, gender, race, ethnicity, sexual orientation, age, and power relations, among others. The shift to visual culture represents a recognition of a vastly changed cultural environment, which includes a new symbiosis between new technologies, new economic arrangements, and changed social formations. There are a number of thinkers who believe that our society has become a society of spectacle. Chaplin argues that never before in human history has imagery been so central to the creation of identity or the gathering and distribution of knowledge. In Baudelaire's opinion, never before have images been so self-referential, arguably so seductive. Heidegger believed that the world conceived and grasped as a picture is what distinguishes the essence of the modern age. Mirzoff insists that the modernist fascination with the visual and its effects has engendered a postmodern culture that is at its most postmodern when it is visual. During the heyday of modernism, social class reinforced a divide between the arts and the rest of the social life. But now, with their configuring of social class in a postmodern world, the distinction between art and social life has imploded. The once clear distinction between high and low culture no longer exists, as each borrow freely from one another and both producers and audiences move between them. Accordingly, culture is seen not as something that is high and refined, but rather, as William says, culture is ordinary. Culture is an everyday experience. Mirzoff writes, "In the present intensely visual age, everyday life is visual culture. Visual culture, then, is not something special, but something we all possess and practice all the time." Definitions. Though everyone agrees with the cultural shift towards visualities as the characteristic of our age, it is difficult to give a precise definition for visual culture. Unlike art, there is no single institutional framework with which to associate visual culture. B. Wilson elegantly captures the difference between art and visual culture in contrasting the relative ease with which he felt able to map the field of art education with the impossibility of similarly mapping visual culture. Following Deleuze and Guattari's distinctions between tree-like structures and a rhizome, he argues that whereas art education is like a tree with roots, a trunk and branches, visual culture is like a rhizome. A paradigm example of a rhizome is grass, where a continually growing complex underground system puts out lateral shoots or roots or tubers at intervals. In one sense, visual culture refers to a field of study. The field is emerging from different disciplines, though principally sociology, and draws upon numerous theoretical perspectives. Nevertheless, the field is usually thought to be composed of two closely related elements. A focus on ways of seeing, often referred to as visuality, and an expanded range of visual artifacts that lie beyond the art institution. Henderson, for example, defines visual culture as what it is to see and what there is to see. But equally significant is an emphasis on ways of perceiving and reflecting upon visual experience. As a field, visual culture is generally informed by the view that artifacts and their perception are alike in being context bound, that is, they are historically, socially, and politically determined and cannot be studied in isolation from these factors. Moreover, it is usually recognized that visual artifacts exist in relation to other semiotic codes and appeal to sensory modes other than sight, such as language, sound, music, and human gesture, and cannot be grasped without taking those modes into account. Media theorist Nicholas Mirzev has written widely on the topic of visual culture, defining it not as the products of consumer and or high culture, but rather as a cultural tendency towards employing visual information as the privileged mode of representation and comprehension. There are essentially two ways of looking at visual culture. One is to look at what is taking place in a specific period of time and to examine every aspect of what is going on at that particular moment in the course of history. For example, look at the Renaissance and see what is happening politically, economically, culturally, etc. The other way of viewing visual culture is to look at it as a progression throughout history. The idea is that once an image is stored in your brain, it becomes identifiable and does not appear to be foreign to our visual understanding. Visual culture is often observed as a new methodology that looks to ask more interesting questions about the motivations and visions behind art. In her article, Johanna Drucker examines fine art's relationship to mass culture. She argues, the theoretical discussion of fine art as a cultural practice is still largely dependent on outmoded ideas that art defines itself in critical opposition to mass culture. And she believes that fine art and art history are mistaken by not including visual culture within their disciplines. She believes that there is a great gap between what artists use to acquire inspiration and motivation and the theoretical approaches in which the discipline of art history uses to examine these new artist ideologies. There needs to be a way to incorporate and study this new response to modern life. Drucker believes that once there is a dichotomy between art and visual culture, there will be works included that represent modern art of 20th century while incorporating visual images from areas other than the fine arts. Cultural studies have often been criticized as being a critique of aesthetics. It interprets its history in terms of the need to transcend the limited conception of culture handed down by the 19th century aesthetics. The 1990s was the decade when visual studies was establishing itself as a new field of study that promised, like cultural studies before it, to transcend the disciplinary divides and to bring under one roof scholars from different fields such as art, history, cognitive science, literary studies, sociology, philosophy, cultural theory, anthropology, and film and media studies. For some, visual studies were to inherit from cultural studies its emphasis on the critical project of uncovering ideological machinations prevalent in culture. Theorists embracing such a version of visual studies, usually drawing inspiration from Debord's famous criticism of the society of spectacles and other varieties of French iconoclasm, generally viewed aesthetics as an ideology that only served to legitimize the fetishist and alienating character of bourgeoisie high culture. Some other scholars, however, do not agree with it and suggest a more dialectical approach to the relation between vision and culture. Generally, the study of visual culture has been understood as implying a shift from compartmentalized methodologies of art, history, philosophy, visual anthropology, neurophysiology, film studies to a more comprehensive approach. It has also been interpreted as marking a change of focus from the study of the history of objects to the study of the history of reception, response, or reaction to visual phenomena. Visual culture scholars have shown a revival of interest in developing an overarching theory of the image as a universal category present in every human culture. What all these different perspectives on visual culture have in common is dissatisfaction with the traditional division of labor in the humanities and a call for a broader, more inclusive framework. What is the role of aesthetics in this framework? As we have already discussed, not everyone has agreed in letting aesthetics in, the main reason being a widely shared suspicion in the humanities, at least since the 1970s, that philosophical aesthetics commits the deadly sins of ahistoricism, Eurocentrism, formalism, and blindness to cultural differences. Aesthetic vocabulary has also been viewed as dated, irresponsive to the challenges of new media, post-conceptual art practices, and the digital revolution. But it is a curious fact that the anti-aesthetic atmosphere prevalent in the humanities in the first two decades of the formation of visual studies has paradoxically helped aesthetics by making aestheticians more sensitive to universalizing claims about aesthetic values. Thus, visual culture studies today is sandwiched between aesthetic and anti-aesthetic claims. In his book Production of Presence, Hans Ulrich Gumbrett argues that the aesthetic encounter is characterized by a certain presence which precedes meaning and interpretation. Gumbrett is not against interpretation. Indeed, he says that we should conceive of aesthetic experience as an oscillation between presence effects and meaning effects. He writes, "What we call aesthetic experience always provides us with certain feelings of intensity that we cannot find in the historically and culturally specific everyday worlds that we inhabit, prefer to speak as often as possible of moments of intensity or of lived experience instead of saying aesthetic experience, because most philosophical traditions associate the concept of experience with interpretation, that is, with acts of meaning attribution. It seems to be proposed as a kind of pre-social, pre-interpretative phenomenological event and explicitly opposed to the fundamentally hermeneutic project of cultural studies. W.J.T. Mitchell is another important theorist who argues against the kind of interpretative reductionism that ignores the specificity of the visual image. According to him, what pictures want is not to be interpreted, decoded, worshipped, smashed, exposed, or demystified by their beholders. What pictures want, in the last instance, then, is simply to be asked what they want. It is an example of a trend in the past few years to talk about the power of images and to write about paintings as if they have their own agency and as if our own encounter with them at some level escapes the mediating effects of biography, culture, and the social world. To conclude this short discussion on visual culture studies and aesthetics, let me quote Andre Dadajic and Jakub Stejskal, the very question ubiquitous in the debates on visual culture of what is natural and what is acquired in our visual experiences has been a topic in aesthetics at least since the Enlightenment. And last but not least, despite attempts to study visual culture without employing the concept of art, there is no prospect of this central subject of aesthetic theory ebbing away from visual studies. For better or worse, the question of what is and what is not good art will remain with us for some time to come. It is therefore plausible that visual studies can profit greatly from involvement with aesthetics, if only to learn from its past mistakes. Stanworth writes, "We need to look more closely at the historical construction of ideas which have been inherited over time, shape the possible meanings of visual culture today, and affect the choices people make and the action they take." Do you agree with her? Do you feel that images have that much power or control over people? What has happened to visual culture politically, economically, and culturally during the Renaissance? Books for your reference: The Aesthetic Dimension of Visual Culture, edited by Andre Dadajic and Jakub Stejskal Dikovitskaya, Margaret, 2005. Visual Culture, The Study of the Visual After the Cultural Turn, Cambridge, MA, MIT Press. Holly, Michael Ann and Keith Moxie, edited, 2002. Art History, Aesthetics, Visual Culture. New Haven, CT, Yale University Press. Mirzav Nicholas, 2002, The Subject of Visual Culture, in The Visual Culture Reader, 2nd edition, edited by Nicholas Mirzav. London, Routledge. Mitchell, WJT, 2002, Showing Seeing, A Critique of Visual Culture, Journal of Visual Culture 1, 165-181. Here we conclude the session on aesthetics and cultural studies. We'll meet again for another session. Till then, bye.